Do you remember my favorite type of basis? Like orthonormal bases. So what does that mean? If I do U1 and dot it with U2, what am I going to get? So remember, among other things, the dot product is a perpendicular to 10. The dot product is 0, they're perpendicular. And what about if I dot U1 and U3? And what about U2 and U3? And what if I dot U1 with itself? No, it can't be perpendicular to itself. So, we know the magnitude of U1 is 1. But remember, we can compute a magnitude with a dot product. Among other things, a dot product can help us compute a magnitude. So I'm thinking of a number, yet square root is 1. So what's the number itself?
1.
Given that my basis is orthonormal, what's U2 dotted with U2?
1, 1.
Because that has length 1, and that's length 1. This is just a review. I know it's been a while since we've talked about linear algebra things. So is this an orthonormal basis?
Yes.
It is. So these are perpendicular. If I do a dot product, 1/4 minus 1/4, 1/4 minus the 4th. And if you check, the length of each of these vectors is 1.
Yeah.
This is a vector that's not in the space spanned by B. So you've got a four-dimensional space, and B is a basis for a two-dimensional subspace. And this vector, 10, 4, 7, 11, is not in the subspace, but that's what I can do. Is find the vector in the subspace that's closest to 10, 4, 7, 11. So let's say our space V is R4, our subspace W is B. Projection of V onto the subspace. And what I know is that any vector in W can be written as a linear combination of these two basis elements. So again, all of W is built out of these two vectors. And so what I want to do is figure out the coefficients here. How many of the first vector do I need? How far do I need to stretch the second one? So when the stretched vectors are added together, I find the projection of V onto the space. There's only one answer to this question. how do I find these stretching factors?
You dot the first element, you dot that element with the vector and then multiply it.
Perfect. Yeah, so we're hooray for dot products. So as long as it's an orthonormal basis, I can find these scalars just by using a dot product. So this is, let's see, the average of these is 7, and the average of these is 9. So I get a 16 there. And how am I going to find the second scalar?
Dot product.
Dot product again, very good. So yeah, as long as it's an orthonormal basis, then I've got a very simple way to figure out these scalars. All I need to do is take the dot product. 10, 4, 7, 11, 1/2, negative 1/2, negative 1/2. So that's 6 minus 4 is negative 2. This factor, 7.5 group of decimals. So out of all the vectors that I can make out of these basis elements, out of all the vectors in W, this is the one that's going to be closest to this 10, 4, 7, 11. Bring back memories? Okay, then. It's what if I've got a space, I've got a subspace, I've got a basis for that subspace, but I don't have an orthonormal basis. What do you want to do? Yeah, you want to think we got a process that'll turn any basis into an orthonormal basis. An orthonormal basis, then we can do things like this. Yes.
What does orthonormal mean again?
It means that any two different vectors are perpendicular to each other, and the length of every vector is 1. In terms of dot products, if I take the dot product of any two, it's 0. If I take the dot product of any vector itself, it's 1. I might have done this one already. I'll catch you up. I know it's been a while. Yeah, that's the one thing I don't like about tests. It feels like it's, we'd rather talk about new stuff. Go back. Do old stuff. Notes. I was writing your notes already. Is this basis orthonormal? So convince yourself as either if I dot this with itself, 1, 1, 1, 1, dot with 1, 1, 1, 1, what do I get? Then you get? Oh, okay. So the length of that is 2, I agree. So it's, if I dot it with itself, it's 4, square root of 4 is 2. So length 2 is not like 1. Are these perpendicular?
No, no.
Okay, good. It is far away from orthogonal. I'm going to call this W1, W2, and W3. And it's going to be our job to describe the space W with an orthonormal basis. So what I'm going to do is build a new basis with the U1, a U2, throwing W1 in there, except it's too long. So the first thing I'm going to do is figure out the length of W1. So I'd be happy if this had length 1. I'm happy with the direction. It's just too long. So if it has length 2, if I multiply by a half, it'll now have length. The way to get U1 is just to bring the W1 down to the right size. So it's the same direction as W1 and a good size, so I'll keep that. So here's my picture. I've got U1 and represent some direction like this. And my W2 vector is going out like that. And the way I think about that W2 is I can build part of the W2 as an extension of the U1. And then I can go up like this. So this vector is the projection of W2 onto the line defined by U1. And this, I'm trying to find the new basis for W. It's anything I can build out of W1 and W2, I can build out of U1 and W2. U1 and W2 perp give me all of W2. So anything I can build with these two, I can build with this and that. So to find the projection of W2 onto the line defined by U1, that means I'm going to have to extend this U1 by a certain amount. So far, so good?
Yeah.
How am I going to find that scaling factor? How am I going to find how much to extend U1 by?
Dot product.
Dot product. It's the answer to everything. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to dot remember, what I'm trying to find is W2 perp. I know the W2 already, and we just calculated W2 parallel. and luckily they're related. So what I know is that in order to get W2, that's going to be W2 parallel plus W2. We can work this out. W2, add over there, negative 1, 4, 4, negative 1, equals 3 halves, 3 halves, 3 halves, 3 halves, plus. Negative 1 minus 3 halves, negative 5 halves, 8 halves minus 3 halves, minus 5 halves, 4 halves minus 3 halves, minus 5 halves, and all I really care about is the direction here. About that is 5 halves times negative 1, 1, negative 1. Why am I not happy? Well, quick check, is this vector perpendicular to that one?
Yes.
I'm good with that. Why am I not happy just throwing this vector into this spot? It's too big, in fact. So remember, I want this to be an orthonormal basis. So among other things, I want all the vectors to be perpendicular. So let's figure out how long it is. For a while. Good. Get my U2. I'm going to do 1/2. So if I make this half, it already has length 2. If I make it half as long, it's going to have length 1, which is right direction and right length. Two-thirds of my basis. Let me draw you a picture of this third part. So there's my U1 vector. There's my 2U2 vector. And then W3 is going to be a vector out like this. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to work with U1 and U2. To get a W3 parallel. So I'm going to find the vector. Closest vector I can get to W3 just using these two. And then I'm going to figure out the missing direction. So the idea is anything I can build with W1 and W2, I can build with U1 and U2. And I can even build part of W3 with those two. What I'm going to put in my orthonormal basis is the extra piece here that I couldn't build with those two. I'm going to need some room. So I'm going to give you a minute to copy this picture over and erase it. So I'm trying to get W3 parallel. So that's the projection of W3 onto the space spanned by W1 and W2. So in other words, that's the vector, the closest vector to W3 I can build just by using these guys. And instead of using these two as a basis, I'm going to use these two instead. So I'm trying to find the projection of W3 onto the space spanned by U1 and U2. So, stretch this vector by a certain amount. I'm going to stretch this one by a certain amount, and then add those stretched vectors together. What cool linear algebra operation will tell me how to get the scalar for this part?
Dot product.
Dot product,
exactly.
Pray for dot products. Dot those together, and the answer comes out. I want to ask it enough so you're tired of it. You're tired of it already, so you're going to remember on the exam. I'm going to get this. I'm doing the dot product as well. It's 4, negative 2, 2, 0. That's 1 plus 1 is 2, that's 0, that's 0, that equals 2. What did I just calculate here? Good. Yeah, so this is the W3 parallel. So that's the projection of W3. So that's the part of W3 that I can already build with U1 and U2. We want to get the new stuff. So what's that new one called? W3 perp. So remember, our idea is we can build W3, we break down W3 as a parallel part and a perpendicular part. W3 they gave to us, 4, negative 2, 2, 0, the parallel part. We just calculated. And what we need is the perpendicular part. Thank you. experimenting with this. All we really need is this vector. So you get with the length of that guy? Oh, actually, let's point it out. Very good. Yeah, let's work with the original. So first of all, before we do this, so I do a quick sanity check here. Is this perpendicular to the first one? We do a dot product of those, should be zero. Is that guy perpendicular to the second one?
Yes.
Good. Okay. So it's perpendicular to those two. Because the problem might be that it's the wrong length. I'm just going to do 1/4. And that 4 came from right there. So it's 4 times 2 big. So I'm going to get 1/4 as big. 2 negative 2. 2 negative 2. 1/2, negative 1/2, 1/2. Length 1, we already checked it was perpendicular to those two. So what I did is I had a 4, I was working in R4. I took some three-dimensional subspace. I described it by a basis. It's a legit, it's a good way, the best way to describe a subspace. Unfortunately, this was not an orthonormal basis. So what I did was I came up with another basis for the same subspace. Anything I can build out of those originals, I can build out of these. And these are orthogonal. So far, so good? Okay, so all that stuff is reviewed. And now we're going to start doing new things. So this is, what's actually, we're in 5/2. We're going to officially skip 5/3. I'm going to just briefly tell you what you need to know from 5/3. And I'm going to use that to come back to 5/2 and finish up that section. The idea for a transpose of matrix, is you read off a row and you write it as a column. So what's the first row of A? So I write 1, 2, 3 as a column. So what is the second column of the transpose of A?
4, 5, 6.
And the notation we have for that is A, and then a superscript of T. So if B is 10, 4, 7, 11, what's the first column of B transpose?
10, 4, 10, 4.
And the second column of B transpose?
7, 11.
So what I want you to do, oh, actually, let me, it's actually just here, something interesting. What happens if I do the transpose of the transpose? So just like, another word, it's just like we talked about diagonal matrices, some matrices we call orthogonal, and usually in linear algebra, if you're using the letter Q for a matrix, it's understood to be orthogonal. And what an orthogonal matrix is one where the columns form an orthonormal basis. It should be called an orthonormal basis, or an orthogonal basis. Is this an orthogonal matrix?
Yeah.
And what you do is you look at the two columns and ask if those columns form an orthonormal basis. So do you believe that these are orthogonal? If I do the dot product against row.
Yes.
And then if I take the magnitude of each of these. That's 9, square root of 9 25ths plus 16 25ths. And same thing with this one. So they're perpendicular to each other. This has length 1. So imagine that Q is this matrix. Thank you. a slightly different name. You see, I could also read off the column and write it as a row. Kind of color code these two endpoints. So what is the first row of two transposes? And the second row of Q transpose. So if I did this matrix multiplication, do you see that this entry is just the dot product of the first column of itself? And given that it's orthonormal basis, if I dot it with itself, I'm going to get. The entry that goes right here is going to be the first vector dotted with the second vector, which we know is 0. This is going to be the same idea, the second with the first, and this one's the second one. And just so we're clear about this. If I do a matrix like this, 1, 0, 0, 1, times 1, 2, 3, 4, what do I get?
1, 2, 3, 4.
You can work it out for yourself. This is like multiplying by 1. It doesn't really matter. So what we're going to do is we're going to come up. So I'm going to be given a matrix A, and then we're going to do what's called a matrix factorization, is we're going to write A as the product of two matrices. So I'll briefly talk about why you want to do that. And what we're going to do then is A is going to be given. Want to write a given matrix A as the product of two matrices, and we want the Q matrix to be orthogonal, and we want the R matrix to be factoring things. So in arithmetic, if I'm trying to add up two fractions with denominators 12 and 18, you didn't know that. How do I break 12 down? Can't break 3 down. How do I break 4 down? So I'm trying to find common denominators. And if I can break that 12 down into simpler pieces, 2 times 2 times 3 times 3. And how do you break 18 down? If you just say 2 and 9, or you could have said 3 and 6. And no matter how you do it, it's you can break the 18 down into 2 times 3 times 3. And then, if I want to get the least common multiple, I need a 2 and 2 2s. So 12's got it covered. And 3 and 2 3s. So that's 9 and 4 is 36. And In your algebra class, you'd have something like this: solve x squared minus x minus 2 is 0. Remember how to solve this? Are you doing it? Are you doing this in your head? If I made a harder problem, in the trick of factoring, so the idea of a factorization, or factoring something, is to take something complicated, break it down into simpler pieces, and then you can use those simpler pieces to do something. In arithmetic, you did a prime factorization, which helps you find a common denominator for adding fractions. In algebra, you factored this polynomial to make equations like this easy to solve. So, in advanced linear algebra, you're going to want to take a matrix and rewrite it as a product of simpler matrices. And you want this Q matrix to be orthogonal. And this R matrix is upper triangular. So they multiply together and give you the A back. We'll go through the process and we'll talk briefly about why you would care about this. So that's what we just did here. So I'm going to have a matrix A, I'm going to take the columns, go through that whole process to produce an orthonormal basis. So that's how you're going to get the columns of Q. Trying to get the factorization. So we're trying to write A as Q times R. This is what we're going to be given. Do you know how to find the Q?
Yes.
You get the Q, you build the columns of Q, by that whole process you did with the A. So I'll do an example, and we'll be using, basically we'll be using these vectors, the ones we found, to build Q. So what's left to find? And do you see that Q is an orthogonal matrix? So what I can do is I can multiply both sides of the equation by Q transpose. And if it's an orthogonal matrix, what happens when I do Q transpose times Q? It's the identity. They cancel each other out. So I get Q transpose times A is R, or the R I'm looking for is Q transpose A. So I'll put it all together for you. In general, in math, you've got a complicated thing. Sometimes you want to break it down into a product of simpler things. In this instance, the simpler things are an orthogonal matrix and an upper triangular matrix. problem yet. You're going to see some on the homework, some on the next exam. I'm going to give you a matrix A, and I want you to find the QR factorization of A. So what this means is again, what I want you to notice is the columns of A are exactly the basis vectors we had for that B basis I started class with. And we did the whole QR factorization to turn the columns of A into this basis. So far, so good?
So you'd have to go through the whole process of finding those.
Yes, you will.
No shortcut.
Both from alpha or beta. None of the test. Well, actually, you, yeah, there's some fancy calculators. So what's the first column of Q? So I get the columns of Q just from this matrix, or from this basis. Second column of Q is the second. And the third column of Q remember this is U1, U2, and U3. Coincidentally, I'm just talking about that. Transpose. What's the first row of R? I'm sorry, what's the first row of Q transpose?
1/2, negative 1/2. Oh, the first row? Oh, it's just the first 1/2.
Right.
Yeah.
I'm trying to call it into a row. Second.
It's the second.
Yeah, second row of Q transpose and second. R's going to be fairly small. Oh, do you know this trick? What are the dimensions of Q transpose? How many rows?
Three.
Three.
Close.
Four.
Two rows. Oh, well, three rows. Yeah, three rows. How many columns?
Four.
And this four matrix is what?
4/3.
So the answer is going to be 3/3. One half, one half, one half, one half. That is not a coincidence.
It'll be 2 0 0.
It will. So we know it has to end up being implicit. It's essentially this process guarantees that R is already upper triangular. And the reason why these zeros are showing up is because these guys are perpendicular to the first one, or I guess this guy.
No,
this is going to be add them all up. That's 8, 6, that's 3. This one is going to be, let's see, oh, every, yeah. It should be 3 again, right? So, no, 8, 10, 5?
Yeah. And then 0.
And then lastly, this is 2, 3, 2, 7. So this is add them all up. So this is 2. This is -2, -3, -2. And this last one is, let's see, those double up. That's 1, 2, 2. So I'll talk a little bit about what this means. I'll talk a little bit about why we're here. So if I do Q, get A here. But remember that we think about matrix times matrix as matrix times each column vector. And a column vector is tells me the scalars to use on the vectors, on the columns considered as vectors. So the way I'm looking at this is to get the first column of A, that's 2 times this vector, plus 0 times the middle one, plus 0 times the other one. In other words, if I stretch this vector by a factor of 2, I get my original vector. But remember how I got this guy? Is this, I took the original vector and divided it. So what you'll see, I'm not going to go through all of these, that every single number that shows up in R is a number that showed up when we did the QR calculation. Is this entry is going to be the length of the first column. For the second column, it's to get the second column of A, I do 3 times this, plus 5 times that. I've lost track. So it's enough to work it out. But if you go back to your notes, it's what you'll find is the 3 and the 5 are the two scalars you found as you were building up the W2 parallel.
I guess that's it.
Yeah.
And the 3 scalars here, for the three entries for the column of R here are exactly the scalars you got at Washington. This was the scalar, this was the length. These two are the scalars you need to build W3 parallel. And this 5 is the length of the perp. It's how much you had to divide it by.
Yeah.
Briefly, in real life, you're not gonna have 3 by 3 matrices. You're gonna have 10,000 by 10,000 matrices. And unfortunately, when you're doing row reductions, well, you're never gonna do this stuff by hand. So when you're doing row reductions, if what's gonna happen is any errors that you have are gonna propagate through to other vectors or to other rows. So if you take your matrix A and convert it to one where the columns are orthonormal, then the idea is, get a good picture. Any calculation you made with this vector and you introduce an error is gonna introduce an error for this one. But if these are perpendicular, then errors in this direction aren't going to affect what happens in this one. That's gonna be the idea why you want to do QR factorization. That's an important idea in general. Is you got a matrix, you're gonna be doing something with it. If you have some numeric errors that you're gonna introduce in, this is what was called precondition the matrix. So massage it a bit to get a different matrix where the errors are not as important. We're going to see, well, there's famous factorizations. I skipped some already. We're going to talk more about factorizations in chapter 7. We got time? You don't need to write this down. So 5-3, we're going to officially skip. I just want to talk about it. So 5-3 is about orthogonal matrices. Those are matrices where the columns form an orthonormal basis. I'll tell you a couple of interesting things. Is the rows are going to form an orthonormal basis as well. If you think about a transformation as going from the input space to an output space, if you have a vector over here, and then it transforms to a vector over here. If this is an orthonormal basis, the lengths always stay the same. And then the second amazing property is for any two vectors, if this is an angle theta, and it's an orthonormal basis, or if it's an orthogonal matrix, the angle between them stays the same. There's more going on. Those are the big ideas. About to say this next part was one of my favorite parts of linear algebra. Then I realized that all of them are part of it. What we're going to do next. We're in 5.4, and I would expect you're going to have homework on this, you're going to have a test question on this. What I want you to imagine is you're doing a physics or a chemistry lab. And the first part of the lab is collect some data. So the data you've collected, who knows what you're measuring. Got 3-2, 4-3, 5-1. And then you're reading through the lab manual. You're going to write up your report. You say, okay, so your data should be on a straight line, find the slope of that line, and then do something. And so you've plot your data. Here's the 0.32. Here's the 0.43. Here's the 0.51. And they don't make a line. So problem is, what are you going to do? Let's back up for a minute. If we just looked at this and said to make the line that connects all these points, what does the equation of a line look like?
Y equals mx plus b.
Y equals mx. So here's that. So plugging in that first data point tells me that I've got this equation. plugging in the second data point, we've got that equation. And plugging in the third data point gives me that. So as a linear algebra problem, that's what we've got. It's a system of equations. Find the line that connects all of these. You want to solve this system of equations. And unfortunately, it doesn't have a solution. So what we're going to do is we're going to use linear algebra to get at least maybe the best possible solution. Yeah. So let's try some of these. Let's say our line is y equals x plus 2. So if I try this line, what does 3m plus b give me? 4m plus b? 5m plus b? And what am I trying to get? Does anybody have a better candidate? What about y equals 2x plus 1? That's probably going to be worse. How about negative x plus 1? Yeah. So what about 2x, that's 6, how about 2x minus 3? Okay, that's good. So if this is my candidate line, m is 2, b is negative 4. What's 3m plus 2? Cool. That's good. 4m plus 3, what is it? Cool. And? And what am I trying to get? 2. So the way to measure this, it's we can look at the vector generated by our choice of m and b. And we can compare that to the numbers we want to get. So I'm going to think about these three numbers as representing a vector in R3. And 2, 3, 1 is another vector. And I'm going to look at the length, which is that distance, to measure how good I am. So let's see, actually, what is this length? Square root, what's the distance between these points? 5 minus 2, 3 squared, 3 squared, 6 squared, so that's 36 and 18 is 54. And what about this distance? What's this distance here?
0.
What's this distance? What's this distance? So what's a better line? X plus 2 or 2x
minus 4? 2x
minus 4. 2x minus 4. You think there's a better one?
Probably.
Probably. So our job is we want to find the best possible line that fits this data. We're not going to get something perfect. But we want to minimize, this is how we're going to measure the error, how close we got was. What we wanted to get and what we actually got, the distance between those two vectors. So I'm going to write it this way. So in matrix form, this is the system of equations we're trying to solve. You can't solve it, of course. Matrix times a vector with a slightly different perspective is what we're trying to do is build the 2, 3, 1 vector out of these two basis elements. So I can think of my space as being R3. My basis for W. And then what's happened is that 2, 3, 1 vector is sticking out, is it's not in the space W. So we're going to do the best that we possibly can. What are we going to find? Good. Yeah, so we're going to find if this is our vector W, we're going to find the point in W that's closest to this one. So the best possible line you can get is going to be the scalars, the m and the b value we need to build the projection onto this. So you've got one way to do this already. So I'm going to show you a separate second way on Wednesday. But if I stopped you now and had you solve it, how do you find a projection? Dot product? Except, what kind of basis would you need to use that dot product? Orthonormal? So what you'd have to do is you'd have to take this basis, convert it into an orthonormal basis. You know how to do that?
Sin equals 0.
What's that?
Sin equals 0.
No, that was that Gram-Schmidt process. So you figure out the length of this vector, and then you do all the projections. And but you do know how to turn this into an orthonormal basis. You know how to do an orthonormal basis, then you know how to find the W parallel. So it just converts to a U1 and U2. So that's going to be M, that's going to be B. And how do you find the M if it's an orthonormal basis?
Dot product, first one.
Very good. We're going to use a dot product on that. So we'll show you a slightly different way to do it. That's the idea. Cool. So what we're doing is we're going to have a system of equations that has no solution, and we're going to find the best possible solution we can come up with. So there's no exact solution. Some solutions are going to be better than others. We're going to find the best possible one. And that's going to be Wednesday's lecture.